It's my great pleasure to speak now with Tom Wilson, who's not only the chair and not only the president, but also the CEO of Allstate, one of the biggest insurance companies in North America. Welcome, Tom.
Thank you, Ryan. I'm really excited about having this conversation. You've got a lot of experience, so this is going to be great.
And I'm really looking forward to talking to you. I'm no insurance expert, but given the issues that I cover, I look at big global issues like climate, like technology and data. And it just really seems to me like insurance is in this moment where it is at the nexus of a lot of trends. It's going to change as a sector, and the rest of the world is really getting shook up all around it as well. Maybe let's start with some of those tech issues, and then we'll go into climate and other issues. I wanted to get a sense from you. Do you meet tech executives very often? What's the dialogue like between technology and insurance, given the huge role that data now plays in you refining and developing your products?
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, we're basically a data and analytics company that happens to use that information to protect people when bad things happen, and be either help them not have it happen, or when it happens, be there to fix it for them and make sure they get the right price. So we're a huge data and analytics company that has great involvement with all the tech companies. So we track, we obviously use data to price auto and home insurance because we don't know if you're going to have an accident. So we make an estimate based on your world. And we know a lot more about you today than we used to know before. We're also a telematics company. We track over 25 million cars a day on where they're moving, so we can see how people drive, so we can make sure they get the right price. But we also use it, like if somebody has an accident and no first responders around, we can get somebody to them. So we're very much engaged in the whole technological digitization of our world.
And thinking about all of that data being used in so many new ways, I think a big part of the overall conversation now is how big technology companies aren't necessarily using that data in the best ways. I was wondering, where do you draw the line around how the personal data gets used? And where is this discussion going now? Is it a discussion that has to leave tech circles and move into regulation and government circles to make sure consumers aren't getting ripped off and pushed around in how their data is used?
Well, it's obviously a really important question. And for the World Strategic Forum to be focused on, it's really important. Let me go up in a little history and then come to today. So first, if you think about our world, we're in a lot better shape because of the digitization and the use of all the data. When you can connect with more people, your communications are cheaper, you can drive places faster, like just there's so many benefits that have come out of this burgeoning use of data. And I think that's really great. And we see that in our business too. We're much more effective in making sure we price insurance for people because of the data. That said, we're about to run out the string. People don't have any privacy. They feel like they're trapped in a digital world that they're not really sure about. There's companies that are making enormous margins off having free data. So if we're going to keep this up, we have to change. And I think it's going to be comprehensive, and I think it's going to take a long time.
And maybe if I dial it back a bit now and get into some of the root causes of those issues, to try and think about how that discussion is going to move forward. Is the problem really that there's a bunch of cowboys selling data all over the place and that people don't know where the data is coming from and where it's going to? Or is there some other element of the power imbalance that we need to focus on to get a more productive result out of this?
From our standpoint, I don't know if it's the cause of the problem or the opportunity to make it better, is we need to put more power in the hands of people. So let me go what I mean by that. So today we have a product called Digital Footprint because we protect people's identities. The average person in that product, 350 online accounts. There's 1,000 online apps or 1,000 apps that track your location up to 14,000 times a day. You know, the police have half of America's pictures, access to their pictures, you know. Campaign Grid and ProPublica, they've got like, you know this from your political days, they got like data on everybody, like 80% of the population they have data on. So we have this benefits we got left us with this position of having way too much data out there in way too many places. So the question is, what do we do about it? Some people want to just regulate it. I think we need different regulations. Absolutely. I think I would start with giving some more control to people over what kind of data access they give to people. And so I think that's a way we can take what is a problem and we're not optimizing today to make sure we optimize. I think absent that, if we just regulate our way to it, we're going to restrict the data and we're going to lose some of those benefits that are good.
Yeah. Yeah, I come from a background where I worked in Brussels for 12 years, both inside the European Union before I became a journalist and then and reporting on it. And they made a big leap forward with their general data protection law. And that took a long time to develop. And the EU is this very slow decision-making machine. And what came out at the other end was still a fairly rigid set of policies and principles, and I don't think it's really lived up to people's expectations. It's kind of reset the global discussion in lots of ways, but it doesn't deliver for you as a consumer everything that the authors hoped for, and probably I don't see a lot of chance of a law like that coming out of Congress. So if that's the case, is it that consumers need to take more steps to protect themselves? How can consumers get organized? Like, what other than regulation would happen here?
Well, I agree with you that GDPR, as we in this, we love our acronyms in the insurance business, was a good thing. And it was a step forward. But it's like, I think sometimes we want to take all the steps all at once. And like, so it's a step forward. We've complied with it and it's made us better. It's made privacy protections better. That said, it's not the end. I think the next logical step in America would be to bring some standardization and some simplification to what are called privacy statements, which aren't privacy agreements. They're not privacy agreements at all. They're really data access agreements. And we have a concept we're pushing forward, which is four really simple categories, understandable at a ninth grade education reading level, that yep. If you use it as a company, then you can be subject to federal legislation rather than this patchwork of state laws we got coming our way. Yep. And so I think bringing some sanity to that simplification would then have people know, well, what did I really agree to here? Because I don't know about you, but like, you know, I'm getting ready to do something. They say, you click on this. I don't read the thing. I just click through it. Next thing I know, Google's
reading my email. I've never read one of them.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, next thing you know, Google's reading your emails and you're like, well, I didn't really like that. So I think bringing some sanity to it would be helpful.
Mm-hmm. I wonder, what do you think of an idea like paying consumers for their data? Is there a way to have a completely different business model where you allow people to monetize what they're giving away, and then you kind of can more easily measure what each party is getting out of the transaction?
Yeah,
that's a secondary business line.
I like the idea of giving people more control by knowing what I'm giving you access to. That's the standardized agreements. I also like the idea of allowing people to continue to barter it, because I think what we have is an ineffective market solution today. So think about data as a company. And we collect lots of data. We got our SDK embedded in all kinds of apps and stuff like that. It's free. So you collect as much as you can. It costs nothing to store it. So I don't pay for it. It's just there. And so you get as much as you can. And if you have all that data and you haven't paid much for it, companies try to protect it, but it's not like it's gold, you know. But to the individual, it's gold. So I think having some market forces on it, we help. I mean, if you look at Google and Facebook, they take in, I think, $250 billion in revenue, and they make $60 billion. Okay? $60 billion. Most businesses, political, the rest of us, we do not have profit margins at that level. So what that says is the economic system is in balance. So I think if we started with getting some standardization of people know what they're agreeing to, and then you could eventually turn them loose in market forces. There's a whole bunch of issues you'd have to work through. And I think, you know, this is, as I said, this is like a 10-year deal. So we should just buddy up and go do it. But I do think it would be helpful.
Yeah, it seems to me to kind of, not a segue, but it strikes me not just on the data front, but when I think of myself as a journalist and people who create content, what has happened a lot of the time is the tech companies choke off the value creation chain, and they are able to siphon off a lot of the value just at one point in that chain. And the other points of the chain do not get to realize the value that they actually do create in whatever is going on, whether it's the use and the sharing of the data, whether it is a piece of content like a news article. And there's just one part of the value chain that's siphoning off all of the value.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about it, but you're absolutely right. I mean, you just think about the work you write that is valuable and you should be paid for. I see the headline. It shows up. I click through and there's a paywall and I'm like, oh, I got the headline. That's good enough. So, you know, Facebook gets paid for it, but you don't.
Yeah, well, at the very least, you didn't make the mistake of giving away insurance for free. I think that was the big mistake the news industry did for 15 years. We got to teach people that there's value there, and then value costs something. And anyway, we're getting there, but it's been a long route to fix the news industry. So I hope you don't get stuck in the same situation.
No, let me dig in a little bit on these data access agreements to explain what I mean there. So I think you could have four levels. The first would be guest. So guest is when I get on your website, you can't put any cookies in my computer. You can't do anything. I just say, look, Ryan, I want to be your guest. And when I leave, I disappear. Then you could have private, which is if I'm a Politico customer, you can keep the information for what you and I do together, but that's it. You can't sell it. Then you'd have anonymous, which is, yeah, okay, Ryan, if you want to bundle me together with people who live in Chicago and say, here's what they think, and that's of some value, like I'm cool with that. Just don't give my own information away. And then there's open, which is, of course, what you have today, which is you can do anything you want with any of my information. I don't control it. I don't own it. And I think if you had that kind of construct, like if I went to Amazon and I really didn't like Amazon, but I wanted to check a price, so I'd be a guest. But Amazon might say, look, Tom, if you really want to interact with us, you got to be at least private. And they might say, you know, if you're really open, back to your earlier question, if you want to be open and let us use it for other stuff, like we'll give you a discount. We'll give you, your Prime will be cheaper or something. So I think if we could do this in a way that then people would understand it. So when I clicked on somebody's website, I'm like, you know, I don't want to let them know everything about me. I got on this website. We have a thing called Digital Footprint. It tells you how many people track you. And I see Active Auto Parts is tracking me in L.A. And I live in Chicago. One of my daughters had lived in L.A. I'd helped her buy a battery for her car 3 years before. And I'm like I would not have wanted that, right? And in the thing about consumers, they don't want to spend time on it.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I have this situation in Google where it thinks I'm in California because I've turned off some of the tracking. And I'm quite happy to say, no, my home base is here. But what think is really going on is they're deliberately trying to give me material that's a little bit off what I need in order to convince me to be tracked the entire time. And maybe that's a conspiracy theory. Maybe I've got that wrong, but it's certainly the impression I'm left with. And it just doesn't feel like the right choice. Like there are other choices we could be making, the sorts that you are describing. Maybe I need to ask you a couple of questions about climate as well. Sure. I saw that you made some comments when we learned that President Biden had won the election, and the ways that you hoped his climate policies and policy package would unfold. And I wanted to chat to you a little bit about that, because it strikes me that we are clearly experiencing more extreme weather events. Some of them are either amplified or caused or linked to climate change. And I wanted to check in with you about whether you think Biden is kind of living up to the standards that you were setting for him. Are we better pricing these events and better reflecting the true cost that we're experiencing from climate change?
Well, I think dealing with a changing climate is one of the biggest economic and societal things that we have facing us right now. Like, it's huge. The climate is definitely different. Like, if you look at in our world, number of 1 in 100 year storms, there's like four of them in the last 10 years or something. And you're like, okay, well, obviously that math is wrong. So the weather is much more severe. It's because the climate is warmer. We have chosen not to focus on the genesis of it. Like, how did it get here? But like, what are we going to do about it now that we're here? How do we make sure people's homes are protected? How do we make sure they have the right kind of coverage if something bad does happen to them? How do we have enough first responders? The Biden administration is clearly focused. I think a lot of politicians hopefully are focused on it. I think it's too early to tell how successful they will be. I'm optimistic that they're doing a lot of the right things. So the work they're doing on the flood programs in the United States, government's been mismanaging that forever, which is why private insurers like us don't sell flood insurance, because they sell it too cheaply to people who have the same event five times, you know, and you're like, that's not a plan. So I think there are steps along the way. I think they need to focus on
if we can. Let's clarify that for everyone listening and tell me if I'm getting wrong in the summary. But essentially, the administration is going to rebalance or remove over time the subsidies that are provided to certain homeowners now. And the point is to try and rectify the flood insurance market to reflect the real risks that people face living close to coasts and bodies of water. And that's going to be difficult for some people because their premiums are going to go up, but maybe it will make the market more functional. Maybe more insurers can get into the market when that happens.
That's exactly what they're doing. And the trick is do it over time. Like, you don't have to, it's a government. You don't have to do it in 2 years. If you're a private company, you got to make money relatively quickly. If you're the government, like, take 10 years, but don't waffle. Don't let a politician say, you know, I got these 100 voters and they're really mad. And I know we've rebuilt their house 3 times, but like, it's, they're okay. That's exactly what they need to do. But the government needs to do a lot more than that. And I think I'm also optimistic that that capitalism will actually fix some of this problem. And I'll go way up for a minute. If you think about business and capitalism, businesses, we get paid, make money because we solve problems. Yep. We give you information through Politico. I protect your house if you have a storm. And this is a problem. Society's decided it's a problem and we need to fix it. So we think that there's going to be a great opportunity to invest in climate change. And so we're actively building climate investing capabilities so that we can put capital behind these things, because we think it's in society's best interest, which is part of what we exist for, but we also think it's in our shareholders' best interest.
Yeah. And where do you think the role for government exists? You know, we're in this gray zone where everyone is reorienting to become greener. Like, even if people don't agree on why this is all happening, it does feel like nearly every business and most governments are all sort of training their forces on how to deal with climate change. But we're stuck in the zone where the big long-term 2050 net zero targets are there, and a lot of the milestones along the way are missing. And, you know, in a sector like insurance, you just have these billion-dollar losses just pile up again and again and again. Does the government need to step in to provide some form of safety net around these things to avoid seeing a bunch of insurance companies just going bankrupt, essentially through something they can't control?
Yes. And because some events are just, not only can you not control it, you can't predict it. If you can't predict it, you can't price it. And therefore, you shouldn't sell it. So let me give you an example. Force 5 hurricane in Dade County in Florida is probably $100 billion event. There's not enough money in the homeowners insurance business to pay for a Dade County event. Yet people need that protection. So what we've done is I spent 10 years in DC, not living there, but back and forth trying to convince the federal government to do something. They really didn't do anything. What we did then is we morphed to the states. And so we have a Florida hurricane windstorm pool. We have a Texas pool. That's still not enough, Ryan. The federal government still needs to step in. They have a model. It's called TRIA, the Terrorism Reinsurance Act. And they could use that model to create and enable this transition. I think what you're right. We haven't really focused on the transition from carbon-based world to a more green environment. And I think the government could help in insurance. I think there's a whole bunch of other ways it could help too.
Yeah. And are there any examples from around the world that you guys look to, or is it something that has to be developed domestically and suited to, you know, particular weather patterns or particular conditions in the US?
Well, the United Kingdom has a larger pool, so there's there, but nobody really has the money at a government level or the exposure from a property standpoint the United States has. Like we're the richest country in the world, and we've built everything along the coast, which is where the disasters are, or the fires are, or the earthquakes are. So, you know, we have it all.
I'm from Australia. You can tell from my accent. And my parents, you know, like one of their main interactions with the US is extreme weather events that they see on the TV news. And they just, their jaws are on the floor on a regular basis. And these are people who live through massive wildfires. So they also know extreme weather, but they cannot believe the amount of extreme weather that exists in the US.
And it's only going to get worse. Like, you know, I mean, some of this is, of course, bad forestry and stuff like that, but it's just, it's hotter. There's more precipitation, less precipitation. The winds are stronger. The water's warmer. Like, this stuff is not changing. And so we think one of the key parts of the Biden administration, focus on remediation. Like, what are we going to do when it happens? Mm-hmm. We should focus on how do we get carbon out of the air and get to a place. But this whole transition of like, what are we going to do while it's getting ready to happen is really important.
Maybe the note to end on is to ask you what's on your mind right now? What are you worried about? And what can we all do about it?
I think, you know, obviously climate's a huge risk for the country and companies like us. I think cybersecurity and getting our arms around the digital world is really important. I'm a little worried that because it's sort of like a gangly teenager, the digital world, it needs to be controlled a bit, that we're going to try to like give it a haircut and we should do that. But I'm a little worried that we're going to restrain it, that we're not going to get to where we could be with even better digitization. So getting those rules in, and then cybersecurity is, you know, somebody's going to get hacked. I mean, people get hacked all the time. There's companies either know you've been hacked or you don't know you've been hacked, but everybody's been hacked. Yeah. And so how do you, like, that's really important, because from a political standpoint, think about it, it's cheaper, better, and more effective to wage cyber warfare than conventional warfare. So I think these political states that are not in line with our interests are going to do more of it. And we need to protect our people and our companies against that.
That's actually super interesting. I hadn't thought about the cybersecurity angle, but because you deal with so much quite personal information, you know, and not just in your line of business, like it's obviously true in health insurance businesses as well. You know, how much harder has that made your job? Like, knowing that you're subject to these other risks, I imagine that it's actually a huge investment and this kind of permanently moving target. Like you essentially must have teams of people who think only about cybersecurity now.
It is, and we do. We spend hundreds of millions of dollars a year. It's very sophisticated. You got to outrun the criminals, and the technology keeps changing. And you can't possibly lock all your doors. It's like your house, if you could lock all the doors and windows. But because you're connected to the rest of the world through the internet, there's always some way in. And so even with really good locks, if they get in, you got to make sure when they get in, they can't get to the stuff you want them to get to. And that's complicated. But it's important. And I think I think one thing the government could do is it's kind of like we need a fire department. You know, like if your house catches on fire and you start a kitchen fire or you spill the grease or something, like you call the fire department. I think we need kind of a cyber fire department where, like, if somebody hacks me, like, it's our responsibility. I got a bunch of people spent. I'm doing all I can. But if, like, China somehow outwits us, I need to be able to call somebody and say, hey, I need some help. So I think a cyber fire department would be really helpful for us.
Yeah, I agree with that. If you don't know where to call, it's hard to put out the fire. Tom, thank you so much. That was a fascinating conversation.
Thank you, Ryan. I really enjoyed our conversation, and good luck to you.
Thank you.
And I hope that everybody reads your articles and pays for it.
Awesome. That's exactly the right message that we want to. We want everyone to believe that. Thank you very much, Tom. You can come work at Politico when you do.